technology can change how we feel, fundamentally, viscerally. Making technology is an essential part of what makes us human. But what we make also changes us. We co-evolve with what we make. Our hands probably are the way they are because of the tools that we made. They co-evolve to use those tools. So it matters what technology we make and how this is going to change us. And these days it matters even more. We are now at a time where technology is becoming a lot more intimate. We have tiny electronics and the connected Internet of Things. And so we have wearable technology that is on our bodies. So when it is so close to us, being human and how it will change us, really matters. And right now, the way wearables are is something like this. Sensors, lots of sensors, monitoring our every activity and serving us with data about it. So is this useful? Yes, probably. If I want to lose weight, I can use this to monitor what I eat and what I burn, calories in and calories out, and then try to eat less than I burn, which is easier said than done. Because first of all, this is not really how we behave. Most of what we do is not a conscious decision. Evolution over millions of years managed to embed most of our cognitive processing in our autonomic nervous system, in our hormonal system, which is how it should be. It should run in the background. Most of what we do should run in the background so that it leaves our mind free. I would like to have my mind free to do what it is good at, to think and feel and dream of stuff. And this data, it demands my attention. It adds to the information overload. That's not how we are. We don't process data. We experience. We feel. And that's where technology being human is relevant. And that's where feelings being the future of technology is what is coming. And our body is the key to this. Our feelings are intimately tied with what is going on in our body. At doppel, we are a team of scientists, designers, and engineers. And what we do is we look at how our body affects our feelings and our emotions, and therefore our cognitive processing and what we do and how we behave. Wearables are a key part to making technology human, because how we feel is influenced by our body. And technology that is on our body can influence how it is. So psychophysiology is the science that we look at. Psychophysiology is the science that looks at the interaction between your body and your mind. And it studies essentially the physiological mechanism that underlie psychological processes and how these affect how we feel in order to understand our emotions and how our emotions influence our cognitive processes. To show you what people do in psychophysiology, I'll talk about the rubber hand illusion, which is one of the, you might have seen it, it's one of the weirdest and most studied experiments in neuroscience and psychology. So here's how it goes. I put in front of you, where your hand would normally be, a fake hand, the rubber hand. And I hide your real hand somewhere where you can't see it, behind a screen. And then I caress your real hand and the fake hand exactly the same way. So after a couple of minutes, something really weird happens. Your body starts disconnecting the real hand. In fact, the temperature of the real hand drops, it gets cut off. And it starts adopting the fake hand, which you know really well, it's fake. It's fake. And if I pick up a hammer to hit that fake hand, you'll squirm. You will expect to feel pain. So why does this happen? The mechanism behind this is multisensory integration. And what's really nice about this experiment is that it reveals this window between the mental and the physical. So multisensory integration is a mechanism by which we integrate what comes into our senses to make a story, to make sense of what happens around us, and also who we are and how we are. So in this case, you are seeing a hand where your hand would normally be. It feels like it's in the right place. And you feel what you see happening to it. You feel the touch exactly the same way as you see happening to it. So there is a conflict. And your brain resolves the conflict by going, bye, I'll take you. That seems to be the way to go. And there is actually more that you can do. There is a marble hand illusion. In the marble hand illusion, I lightly tap your hand. And I do it in sync with the sound of a hammer tapping a piece of marble. And that makes your hand feel like a piece of marble. It feels heavy and rigid. And if I was to hit that, then you don't expect to feel pain. And I can ask you to tap your fingers and manipulate the sound of your fingers, the sound of the tapping fingers, to sound like it's coming from far away. And that makes your arm feel really long. So the point of this is that it shows you that your sense of yourself is actually plastic, is not set in stone. And it's a dynamic outcome of everything that happens to you. It is what your own sense of self can be changed depending on what is happening. And now, if you have just a bit of a design streak, I'm sure that over coffee break you can come up with a dozen ideas of what to do with this. I mean, you must. This was one of ours. Is the iPad hand illusion. But that's not what we did. We wanted more. We want to go a level deeper. And so we zoomed into something really fundamental and basic to who we are, our heart and our heartbeat. So our heartbeat and its connection to feelings has a really interesting history. Of course, you know, since time immemorial, our heart is connected to love and to being scared or surprised. Your heart jumps a beat. We think, we've always thought, or we make songs that sing about how our heart feels. But in fact, in modern times, we've demoted the heart. And we think that everything happens up in our mind. And we have, heart surgery where you unclog the heart. So the heart is a pump that you do some plumbing to it. And instead, you're going to do some scanning on your brain to find the locus of your feelings. Which leaves us with a puzzle, which was first stated by William James in 1884. Is your heart pounding because you're scared? Or are you scared because your heart is pounding? Because when you are scared, your heart is pounding. So what is going on? And this question has been studied extensively by neuroscientists and by psychologists. And the answer is that both are true. Your mind and your body constantly talk to each other. It's a feedback loop. In fact, the heartbeat is a very important part of who we are. Some of us are more aware of our heartbeat than others. People who are more aware of their heartbeat, they are emotionally more expressive, and they also feel with greater intensity. People who are not so aware of their heartbeat, that, for example, they may have eating disorders. There's a correlation. The heartbeat can affect how we feel, even on a sound. Listening to a heartbeat can affect your emotional judgment. So our question was, we know that your heartbeat can affect your emotions. And we know that it is possible to adopt something inanimate as your own, like in the case of the rubber hand illusion. So is it possible to adopt an inanimate heartbeat as your own? How would you react to it? What would happen? And so we tried it. This is a heartbeat. It's a motor beating like a heartbeat. We made one, and we put it on people to see what happened. And they reacted to it. So when it was beating at the resting heart rate, they would feel calm. When it was beating at a good clip, they felt energized. And when it was fast and loud, they didn't like it. That made them upset, which was quite interesting. So we kept going. We put it on hundreds of people. These are sleeves with electronics inside them. We distributed out for alpha testing. Asked them what they did with it. They used it in real life settings. They focused at work. They set their pace at exercising. They calmed down in stressful situations. They said it worked, which was super interesting. But of course, we come at it with a science background. And the next question is, well, how do we know? Are they telling us what we want to hear? So what we wanted was a rigorous and objective scientific measurement, which in our case was focus, measuring focus. So we went to experts to do independent testing. So doppel was tested by Professor Manos Tsakiris, who is an expert in psychophysiology at Royal Holloway, University of London. And they used standardized reaction time tests, control tests, to measure focus. And waiting for these results was very stressful, I'm not going to lie. But the results came in, and they were good, better than we expected. In the right conditions, this artificial heartbeat doubled focus, this doubled focus, which is remarkable. So is it strange? Should you be surprised? Actually, you shouldn't be, because you use the same thing all the time when you pick a rhythm to get on with your day. When you want to go for a run and you take your iPod and you put it on and it makes you run faster. When you want to wind down at sleep and you put slow music. You choose your rhythm. And we respond to rhythm. We don't just perceive it, we entrain to it. Faster rhythm makes us energized and slower rhythm makes us calmer. And this is what's going on here. Essentially, the heartbeat is the most ubiquitous biological rhythm, and you respond even more strongly to it. And in fact, quite a lot of music does use a double beat, like a heartbeat. Take the Jaws theme. It's da-dum, 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 da-dum. What it is is a heartbeat that gets faster. And that's what makes it scary. You respond to it viscerally. So that's what this does, too. It's a visceral response. Except in this case, we have a rhythm that you feel. You don't have to hear it, so you can use it in all sorts of situations. Like I'm using it right now. I use it when I give presentations. So when I have to talk, I set it at my resting heart rate. And the message is, everything is calm, everything is fine. Nothing exciting, it's OK. Be calm. It's just going back to James's feedback loop. You give your body a push in the right direction, and then it does the rest. So, but of course, we are designers as well. So what we care about at the end of the day is experience, which is a step beyond the science and the testing. And we wanted to make something that is an experience, not just a device, that fits in with people's lives so that they can use it when they want it, where they want it. So we looked for things like what stimulus to deliver, how to deliver it, where in your body, usability, load on our attention, and so on. So we kept making. We looked at the position on the body, tried that in a lot of places. And it is interesting, probably as you would expect from everything I've said now, that wasn't obvious to us back then. It works best when it is put where you feel your pulse. It is your other pulse. But not every place where you feel your pulse would work. So for example, if you put it here, then the motor resonates with your skull, and that's unpleasant. If you put it near your heart, that's actually too weird. Somehow having two hearts in the same place is unpleasant. So people didn't like that. And if you put it down there, it's hard to control. So here ended up the place to be. So I have another pulse on the inside of my wrist, which I can control to do what I want. Then in terms of the actual device, we want to make human technology, so it was important to enhance the human connection to it. So there are no buttons. There are no screens. You have human interactions with it. You stroke it to calm down, and you give it a tap to get going. No data. You don't have to see a graph. It can do what you want. No data. It is something that you touch and that you feel. It's also yours. It's tied to your body. So it needs to know what your resting heart rate is to work the best. So it calibrates itself to that. So you can have technology that fits with your life, that uses who we are to get us to the next place where we want to be, to do what technology should always do, make life easier for us. And we do think, having spent years working on this, that wearable technology is a really interesting place, is a place to focus on for what will make technology human going forward, because of the connection with our bodies, because our bodies do have the key to our feelings, because our cognitive processes do not happen from here up. It happens through everything that we are. And because we now have more and more of an understanding of what that is. And we don't think that wearable technology is going to be this. This is the Hollywood slash science fiction cyborg future. And instead, what we have is this huge opportunity for this more subtle and natural technology that is part of us. And it's interesting that often, you know, artificial really has come to mean something fake, insincere, or hollow. And actually, artificial is one of the most beautiful things that we do. It's a wonderful thing that we make stuff. And artificial and natural do not have to be opposites. And in fact, in the case of wearable technology, they cannot be opposites, or it's going to fail. So our lives are complex and rich. And as technology becomes complex and rich, it has to respect who we are. It has to be human. We have to make it human. We have to stay human. The body is the key to this. So it's senses, not sensors, so that we can make technology that helps us do and be what we want to be on our own terms. Thank you.